Well, welcome to episode number 75 of According to Flint, and the 75th anniversary is the Aussie episode. Apparently, first Aussie. We've had Canadians, we've had Brazilians, Texans. That's like a whole different country. So Brendan, our friend Brent, many times PBR. How about this? Former PBR great. Now PBR team's commentator in the booth, our friend Brendan Clark. Good. You know, we never really lost touch, but kind of like, yeah. It's kind of cool when you show back up and we just pick back up where we left off, you know?
I know, that's interesting. Cause that's kind of how Luke Snyder and I were having that conversation the other day, exactly the same thing. We, you know, with things that go on and you change direction in your life and you kind of don't keep up with people. And then all of a sudden you're just like, oh, we just been talking a week ago, and it was like, yeah, so it's good.
That's funny. You go through kids and wives and careers, and then it all circles back. And we come back together. I stopped you and I, just so everybody knows, before we started recording, I stopped a conversation because it was too good to have off camera. And Logan, who helps me, said, do you have a good Australian accent? It's like the Canadian accent, any of them. If I'm around, I start saying, yeah, yeah,
yeah.
But the best accent I ever had, because I had just hung around a whole bunch of you guys, was when I did the Australian bull snake, and it's on YouTube. And you were saying, you remember that, right?
Yeah, I was at the PBR finals, and it was during a commercial break. And it had just walked out where that rope fell off the bull right in front of the shark cage. And you were doing that thing. And I was the first rider after the break. And I'm sitting up there trying to get in the right frame of mind, if you would. And then you're doing this Australian bull snake thing. And I was in tears laughing. And I'm trying to think about getting on this bull or whatever. And yeah, that was actually, that's one of your best. That was one of your best. Not only one of your best accents, that's one of your best performances, I think.
It's I remember being in Australia, being around Australians. I think the people who aren't very good, and I'm out of practice, but they put too much effort into the accent. Right. How good on ya? How ya? Yeah. It's more of a relaxed. I learned that. You kind of relax and you just let everything kind of flow. And then if you're not in the arena, you're in the arena.
In the arena. Yeah.
But I did okay. I felt like that. Have a bloody look at him. Danger. Yeah.
The whole dialogue or the way it was perfect. It was the accent mightn't have been like exactly right on, but the whole presentation of how it was supposed to be said was perfect. Because we have this weird thing where, like, Australians, I joke to everyone, I'm like, Australians have three meanings to every word, and it just depends on how you say it is how it comes out and how it's used.
Do you have an example? Give me an example. Or are they too dirty?
Well, the easiest examples are the dirty ones.
Well, I know.
But like, well, let's just say, for instance, you're like, you could say, let's just say there's someone, you know, oh, look at that bloody idiot over there. And you could just be like, it doesn't really mean bad, like, you, whatever. But then you're like, look at that bloody idiot over there. Like, it's just how you direct it. You're like, or you could say to him, oh, you're a bloody idiot. And it means,
right.
Yeah, it's kind of, yeah.
We're that way with the F word or shit or, you know.
True.
Yeah. You guys have one dirtier than that. That means a lot of things.
It does. And it can be said several different ways.
Different ways too. Yeah, of course. Well, I will say, we'll move on, but I could say, like, I did a podcast and I put together like four, went on YouTube. We took the videos off YouTube and I showed like four different situations of shows where I use certain material, you know, the entire commercial, something you're playing off of. I would have to say that the bull snake one at World Finals, it just, the whole thing fell together right yeah. before and completely open in my ear. They're going, Flint, you have like 4.5 minute commercial here and we got nothing. It's all you. And that rope landed there. I mean, the reason it has never really been recreated is that it was what we call shithouse luck, like right. fell together.
Yeah.
I would have to say in all my years, PBR wise material, that maybe was the greatest segment I ever did.
I agree. I mean, I was lucky enough to be there for 10 years of it. And I would have to agree. I mean, I've seen a lot of them and I've seen a lot of different ones and new ones and what, like, it was, yeah, I agree. And again, it was, I think you may have tried it again somewhere before, after that, but it was, again, not that it wasn't as good, but it was like, that was perfect, seemed like it was perfect timing.
Well, I had done it at rodeos for a couple of years before that. I had the tan Steve Irwin suit, but there was just something about that moment that, I don't know. It was cool. But anyway, conversation we had that I've covered is people asking, now that you're in the TV, on the TV side of thing, as am I, people saying, oh, do you like doing TV better than in the arena?
Yeah.
TV's an offshoot of what we truly loved and were good at. So to ask one of us if we like it better, I am a believer in dumb questions. And I think that's a dumb question. Because we got to have the love for what we were doing in the first place to gain that knowledge to then spew it back out to people. Agree?
Right, 100%. I would have to say for sure, I definitely don't love the TV more than I loved riding bulls. That is 100% of the thing. But you're right. I'll never say I'm great at it or the best at it or whatever, but that's what it have been able to explain the knowledge that you know about the sport or what's happening at that particular moment, or to relay a message from someone, as in your job, really, as you're relaying a message that you've heard or talked about to the viewers in, I guess you could say, layman's terms, or an easier way, or just, you know, it's sure. There's an art to it. It's actually really hard. Like TV, people who are good at TV, I had this conversation on the weekend coming home, actually, from the event with my wife and my wife's stepdad about how it's just... there's so much going on at one time, and people that are, you know, we've watched Craig Hummer for many, many years. Someone like Craig Hummer, or we're now looking at Kate Harrison, who I think is unbelievable at what they do. They just, their knowledge of the game and the knowledge of stats and being able to deliver that a certain way is amazing in itself. But then knowing it is one thing, but being able to do it is another. But yeah, it's... I mean, for sure, I feel like bull riding was definitely, you know, I think I'll always have to say bull riding would be my first love, you know, like over anything. I mean, I feel like I tell people all the time, Flint, and we'll probably get into this a little bit later, but I mean, for some people that have continued to follow me, I've changed directions in occupations, or I guess livelihoods or whatever, and to train horses now. And I always tell people that I think I rode bulls. The reason I was good at riding bulls was so I could open up doors to be better in my next, in what I do now. But I think the bull riding just, I mean, you know how it is, bull riding or rodeo in your case, or it'll never get out of your, always be the love that we, you know, for us.
Yeah. And I do want to talk about all that. It's funny. As you were talking, I make little fancy notes here. One of the my little note I wrote right at the end in the corner is lots going on. If you're not, haven't been in TV, like you watch those guys, you know, great broadcasters in America, Al Michaels and Bob Costas and Joe Buck, all those guys. I've had people say, I'd love to do TV. You just sit there and talk about it. You got to listen to somebody. There's so much going on. I've had friends say, I'll do it. Sure.
Go ahead.
Here's the other thing. You and I, all of us in here, we can sit and talk about bull riding or PBR teams, whatever the case. Now put together a paragraph without going, or stumbling over a word or screwing up a name. We do it in conversation all the time.
Yep.
That's what gets you. You're inevitably going to have some ums and stumble over words.
Yep.
But man, there's a pressure there, isn't there?
Like, oh, there is.
Spit this out, man.
Yeah. You've got to, and in it, you've got to, it's got to come to you like right now. And then you've got to be able to relay it all while someone's in your ear talking to you while you're saying it. That's the part people don't understand. I was trying to explain that to my wife. I'm like, yeah, you'll be, it always fascinates me, you know, like when we'll talk about, I guess Kate, most people are probably most familiar with Kate and Craig Hummer, but like just on the weekend, the last 3 weeks, it's impressed me so much that, you know, like when we're going in and out of commercial breaks, especially into a commercial break, when the producer, Jason Duquette's in her ear and all of our ears, counting down from 15 or 10 mid-sentence, and they're just rolling it off their tongue. And then at 1 second, they just, boom, cut it off. It's like, wow, that's, to me, that's an art, and it's hard. And it's not all, TV is not all it's cracked up to be. It's definitely fun to do, and it's not everyone can do it, and some people are better than others. But like we have to, you know, the meetings we have to plan what we're going to try and do, and then maybe what we plan doesn't even work out, and you have to flip it and just have something else. And that's very hard, I think.
Not to keep going on about, but to me, it's an interesting topic because there are not many people to talk about it too, but yeah. I've spent the last 30 years in the arena. I am this far away from what's going on with the announcers and the bullfighters, and I know none of it now because I have these in and someone, and that is my argument about two directions, either pumping TV commentators into the live arena, which we tried last year and didn't work, or what Cowboy Channel does where they take the in-arena announcer and put it on TV. They are not the same thing. We're selling two different shows, basically. Yep. So it's amazing how far apart they can be sometimes.
Yeah, and it's funny because you've actually had that experience, you know, probably more so than everybody else has, where now you're in the TV world and you've been in the other side too. And it's get very interesting because we, like you say, well, I have the headphones on and you have your, like, we don't know anything about what's being said in the arena, like at all, because we're just having a conversation between the five of us. And your job is, I think, hard. And Luke, I know Luke Branquino, we talked about this, is where you're having to listen to what we're saying all the time, the whole show, be ready to, so you're ready to be like, jump in whenever you need or you have something. And that's hard because it's hard to explain to people when you've got to be on for two hours and 30 minutes or maybe a little longer. Like you have to be on for that long. It's very mentally draining.
It is. I'm almost as tired after one of these shows as I was physically the other shows. See, but you're in a booth, you turd. So you're in a booth. I'm behind the shoots and every person that walks by talks to me. Hey, well, I can't hear them for one. And then I'll go. What's that? Oh man. And then you guys are saying something. Whoa. Cause I can't miss what you guys are saying. Right. Yeah. It's a cycle of, I'm so unsociable behind the shoots. Like,
Yeah. You almost got to hide a little bit because you don't want them to talk to you, but then you want to see what's going on. And yeah, no, the other day, actually, when we tried that new opening where we all had our little spots and for some reason, Jason thought it was a great idea that I would do my spot behind the bucking chutes. But then in the time that it took you and Luke to do both of yours, which was about 45 seconds or a minute, I had to run all the way to the other end of the arena, jump the fence and climb up the stairs to get there. And when I got there, I was like, and Matt Rex's wife's like,
I talked like, slow, man. I tried to give you
time. You did me a favor. I know. I was just like booking it in through the middle of the arena and I had to jump the fence. And I was like, yeah, that was a great idea, Jaquette. Great idea.
In the arena. You know, you're not foreign to TV. I mean, you did TV years ago. You did some this past year. So it's not like you're jumping in from scratch, but you have mentioned that, you know, different people have different opinions about the PBR team's stuff, but you have said even on TV, you turned that on and it sucked you back into bull riding again. Like, hey, this is different. I'm going to watch this. It did kind of pull you back. That's what brought you back into the fray a little bit, isn't it?
Yeah, it actually did. So how it went was my son here at our house, we don't have regular TV. So we just have, you know, Netflix and all the internet and the free TV because we don't spend a lot of time at home. So, or in the house. So my son was flipping through the channels and found Pluto and was watching Pluto, the he turned it on and there was a PBR on a Pluto on Pluto. So he started watching it and it was kind of cool. They showed some older stuff on there. So back when I was riding, they showed and he got, and then one day he seen me on there and that was cool for him. So then every time, you know, he'd turn that on and watch, and then there was a team event on. And I was kind of, I was on it. Honestly, I was real skeptical about, I'm like, yeah, this is stupid. There's not going to work. Oh, they're paying these guys too much money and blah, blah, blah. And then
get off my lawn. Get off my lawn.
Same as everybody else. Yeah. So anyway, but then I started watching it and I was like, man, this looks cool. So we were in our Snafflebit Futurity is in Fort Worth, right when the event in Fort Worth was on last year. And the team event, and of course, I was following it on social media, and because of Luke Snyder and Ross Coleman, I and Colby Yates, I kind of, because we all traveled and hung out and roomed together, I followed them mostly, and it kind of looked interesting, and then I went to the event, and I'm going to say it had to have been probably by the fourth ride in the first game, I was hooked. I was like, this is cool. Like, this is actually, to me, it's way more fun because it's really nothing about, it has nothing to do with bull riding, as in, like, it doesn't matter the ride's good or bad. I mean, high point, low point, doesn't matter. You just have to stay on. It's the simplest form of bull riding I think you can even ever have, because you just have to beat the guy you're competing against. And I thought it was an easy concept because I took my wife there and I had another friend that trains horses. He's from Italy, but he's watched the PBR from way back when I was riding and took him to watch. And all of them were the same. They were like, man, that was cool. Well, now, you know, like fast forward, I followed it all the way through the finals last year. And then, yeah, I mean, Shauna Smith called me about doing it. Same with you guys and stuff. And it's interesting because I was so far away from wanting to watch. I bet I didn't watch bull riding on TV for 6 years. Mm-hmm. Like, that's a long time for somebody who did it for a long time to not watch it.
I could do that. I could. And I mean, not, hey, I can do that. I could see myself doing that. You kind of step away. Anyway, I didn't mean to interrupt, but I get it. I completely get it.
And that was because I had, you know, something else going on. And then, you know, most Saturday nights, if I'm home, I'm probably either still working or, I just didn't watch PBR. Anyway, I've had more fun and been more excited about the bull riding in the last 3 weeks than I thought. I actually didn't even expect it to be that way. I truly didn't. I gave it a chance. I was like, yeah, I just didn't want to do a bad job, but I was like, yeah, okay, I'll go back and do it and see how it goes. And I was actually lucky that the PBR gave me that opportunity to be like, you know, let's see how it goes. And you know, you can do one event or all of them or half of them, whatever works in with your schedule. And I tell you what, like, I was pleasantly surprised, and I've been truly, like, the excitement that hopefully I portrays that way, but the excitement that I portray on the camera, like on the microphone or on TV, is truly excitement from what I feel. And there's disappointment there and whatever, but the excitement we feel, and Matt, it's kind of cool because Matt West is the same way. He's just like a little kid in a candy store. You know, he loves bull riding and he's excited about it, but truly it is excitement. And I am enjoying it. And when I say things, it comes across as jokingly or whatever, but it'd be like, if you haven't been to one, and you just go, because it's I know there's diehard Bull Riders fans out there, which I would say you and I are one of them.
Yeah, exactly.
But this whole, fo it's just seeing them guys, the best guys we've ever seen compete are all coaches of them teams, and them, like just trying to work out all the scenarios and what guys bought. It just, for me,
Yeah.
it's very exciting.
Well, Justin McKee, our friend Justin McKee told me one time, you can't sell manufactured enthusiasm. Yeah, I thought that was a great
That's
term for it, manufactured enthusiasm. It just doesn't work, you know.
right.
So it's a sincere, there's something else you said. Oh, sir, it'll come to me in a minute. But you're right. You got to have a true thing. Isn't it funny that you almost said the word format, by the way, and you caught yourself? You
Yeah,
didn't
I did.
say, because I
Thank
had
you, Clint.
format or concept.
Yeah.
You're
And
welcome.
do you know how many times I almost said it during the broadcast last week, and I cut myself off, and I keep on trying to think of, like, man, I've got to say a better word than format or concept.
Was my rule. You couldn't
Yeah.
say format or concept anymore. Yeah, it's for some people to get absolutely like mad about. I've had people message me. I will not watch PBR till this team thing's gone. I said, well, just wait till November then, because then the
Yeah.
regular season starts. It's still bull ride. It's
Right.
I have bigger things in my life that incite strong emotions than just, if bull riding pisses you off that bad, you need to
Yeah.
start a hobby.
Yeah, exactly. Because if you're mad about the fact that the PBRs, and honestly, I was that person. I'm not going to deny it. I was like, oh, this is stupid. But it's actually the complete opposite. I'm like, it's that. I don't think it gets any more fun than Kansas City the other night and last weekend. And I can tell you, and I've said it a lot of times, like my son, I'm going to use him as an example. He just loves it. He thinks it's the greatest. He loves Jose Vitor Lemmy. But I was watching him while I was doing the broadcast. I could see him when I turned around, and I would watch, like, during breaks or something like that, and he was standing up and cheering and whatever. And so, to me, that's a kid that's never been pushed to watch bull run. He has probably been pushed the opposite way, to be honest with you. But it's just such a sincere, like, and then you watch around the crowds. Like, we get to look around and see how people are reacting to different things, and just to see the what how they're getting into it. I think it speaks for itself, and that's, and you can, they're not faking it. It's like a true excitement for what's happening right there.
I just thought of what you were talking about. People should just go, the greatest line not used on TV that I begged you to use, it was your ad. There's a eBay
Yeah.
on the road and it
Sure.
gives a schedule.
Yes.
And if you're from another city, go to another city. If you're from it, we're in California. Let me set the scene. We're in California, and you said, like Oklahoma City. If you're from Austin, there's a good chance you've never been to Oklahoma City because you're from California anyway. And you,
I
no nuts. You had no nuts. You needed to say that line.
I did. I manufactured the way I said it, and I kind of said it, but I didn't say that. I should have said that. I will next time.
You know, I would
Yeah,
have said
I
that.
know you would.
Because who
Yeah,
can
but
be
you can get
offended?
away with it.
You know, it's funny though. People think because you bring something up that it's offensive.
Right.
You didn't. You said there's a chance you're from California. You didn't make fun of anybody.
Hey,
You know.
it's not a non-known thing. Like, half the people, I have friends that moved from California to Austin.
Yeah.
Like, it's the place where they go. They're all going to Texas.
It's fact. It's fact. We've known each other a long time, and whatever. How
Since
many PB?
1991.
That's it. It after you being over here, you're in the PBR. We get to know each other. You revealed to me that we actually met in 1991, right? That's a great story.
In 1991, I was 10 actually at the time. And January 1991, you were the entertainer at our national finals rodeo in Wingham, New South Wales, Australia.
Wingham, the
And
hillside. Yeah.
we'd never seen, we had a really famous comedy clown in Australia. His name was Rusty Frame. And Rusty did a lot of shows in Australia and is a legend. And but you, the when you were over, you came over, you done things that no one done, you know, like, but the thing that stuck out the most to me was the Michael Jackson. You used to, when you do that, the Michael Jackson, you go out there and when you pull the white glove on, you could dance. Yeah. And then when the glove come off, you couldn't dance anymore. I think if I remember correctly, how the act went?
Exactly.
So that was my first. And I mean, again, you wouldn't remember because I was just a kid, but I'd probably in passing, man, it might have introduced myself or said hello or something, as kids do. But yeah, it's kind of so from that. And then you obviously, as we all know, you here you are now, but we all went in a full circle. But you went on to be, you know, Flint Rasmussen. And so me growing up going, man, I seen him in Australia when I was like 10, and then fast forward 10 years. So that was 93. In 2003, I came back to America and to stay. And that was, so then, and then when we actually truly met there, you know,
yeah.
And that was,
yeah.
So
that all,
that's kind of fun.
So I could calculate, how old are you right now?
42.
So I am 13. So yeah, you were about 10. You were 10. I think I celebrated my 22nd birthday there. So you might have been a little young. Right in there. Yeah. 10 years old.
So yeah, because I'm September, my birthday is. So yeah, I would have been 10, and because it was in January, early in the year. So yeah.
There you go. Look at us doing the math. How'd that process go? You grew you know, you grew in Australia, went for that strong steer riding there. Like, you go to Canada and the steer riding's really a strong part of rodeos over there. Wingham, they had Wingham was great. The manicured lawn hillside, and people get drunk and roll down the hill. It was great. But what was the process? I don't know that I've ever talked to many Australians about the process of success there. What are the steps you take? That's a big move, man. That's a whole culture shift when you decide at 20 some years old to come here. What's the process there?
Yeah, well, I'll start with you. Right. So steer riding, we grew up with calf riding, and then they called it the junior steer riding. So 17 and under, we didn't ride back then. We didn't get on bulls very often, junior bulls very often. It was just steer. So I mean, I tell people all the time, like, we learned to ride, like we actually stayed on a lot, and it was a spurring competition. And so till you're 17, you rode steers, and then you moved on to what we call novice bulls or second division bulls, which are the ones that are a little bit, tend to be easier to ride and not as dangerous. And then you move to open bulls. Well, I actually came to America when I was 18. I just got out of school. So 19, I think I was, and stayed for 6 months in Texas. And I obviously worked out pretty quick. I won some money at a lot of open bull ridings in Texas, and we went to a few in Oklahoma, and I went to maybe one or two PBRs, but got slammed and didn't do any good. And then I realized pretty quick I wasn't good enough. So I went back to Australia, and that was right when Troy Dunnan, he'd won his world title, and he was coming back and forth a lot. And I said to him, I met him, we had our, so back then in Australia, we had this, what our PBR was in Australia then was called CBR, so Championship Bull Riding. Mm-hmm. And then it was somewhat after that, it folded and changed to PBR, and that now we have PBR in Australia. But anyway, I told Troy, I said, I want to go back to America, and, you know, what do I need to do different, and how do I, blah, blah, blah. And he was like, well, because he'd seen me ride, and
he did this.
Yeah, he was smoking. Yeah. And he said he might have had a drink in the other hand too. And he was like, you just need to get more dedicated. So I just started training and, you know, worked at it. And then I pretty much was winning a lot in Australia, more than a lot of bull ridings and stuff. And so I came back. It was actually February of 2003, I believe, and we flew into Los Angeles, and I came with Troy, and he We flew in and went to Anaheim. So it's kind of interesting. And I don't know why, if that's the reason why Anaheim's always been one of my favorites, but it's always been pretty much my favorite bull riding to go to other than Vegas. But so yeah, so the difference to now compared to back then was when you came to America then to the PBR, you came with zero earnings. You didn't have any money
Oh,
once. So
right.
now with the growth of PBR, you have PBR Australia, Brazil, Canada, and you can make money, win money, and then that helps you get maybe to into some of the bigger touring pros or whatever they call them now. And then with a chance to get into the Built for Tough series. So that's how my journey was, is I just was like, I'm going. And when I left, I told mum and dad, I was like, I don't know how long it'll be before I'll be home because I'm not coming back till I make it. So yeah, I went, Troy set me up, but we went to Texas, and then I got a ride from Texas to Canada with Denny Hay, bronc rider.
Oh my God.
Yeah,
No way.
I knew nobody. Like I had no there's a lady in Texas that used to, a lot of bull riders used to stay with, a lot of Canadians stayed with, Ann Harris is the name. I stayed with her and she organized, because they'll roll at maybe San Antonio or Austin or somewhere at the rodeo, and they'll go on back to Canada. So I just got in with them and rode all the way up to Canada. And I remember
And
parts of that ride. It was, yeah, I remember we pulled in somewhere to eat on the way up there, and I ordered, because I was on this fitness kick. Like I didn't eat bad, I did whatever. Anyway, I ordered the chicken, and I was sitting there and I ordered the chicken, and Danny Hay stops, and he would, he's, I bet he wouldn't even remember me now, but he goes, he looks at me, he goes, "Chicken? Can't eat the chicken." He said, "If you eat chicken, you ride like a chicken." And I was like, "What?" So I was like, "Well, should I not eat ride? Should I not eat the chicken?" I mean, so yeah. Anyway, now,
Denny Hay would, that would be an education for a new young Australian,
yeah,
Denny
it
Hay.
was. So then they dropped me off somewhere. Yeah, they dropped me off somewhere, and that's when I met at some rodeo. I can't remember, somewhere between Calgary and Edmonton, and that's where I met Scott Schiffner. And so I've pretty much known Scotty my whole, time I've been in America. Anyway,
And now
I went up there.
coincidentally,
Yep.
the events you can't go to, is he gonna, that do TV, is Scott Schiffner gonna step in for you?
That's what, yeah, that's what they,
Tentatively.
I've heard. Yeah, that's what I've heard. He's going to do maybe some of them. Yeah. So the
Yeah.
ones that I
Anyway.
can't go to. So, but anyway, so yeah, I was on my way to Edmonton for the PBR. So that's kind of how I got here. Still no money, one. Anyway, so I got a ride, and I forget who I got a ride up there from. Maybe Kelly Armstrong. I think I might have got a ride from the rodeo to Edmonton with Kelly Armstrong. And we, anyway, I remember going, I remember getting to Edmonton for the PBR. I'd never been to one before, and I'm excited about it. And I go up to the ATM because I've got to get money out. And I forget how much. I'm pretty sure entry fees were like $350. And I go up to the ATM and I put my card in and I get $350 out, and the little paper comes out and it tells you how much money's left in your account.
How'd that go?
And I had $350 left in my account. So I have enough to pay my entries for the event I was at, and then the one the following week. And I was staying with Troy had hooked me up to stay with Austin Beasley, Canadian bull rider.
Oh, yeah.
And so I rode my bull at Edmonton. I was 81 points, didn't make the short round, so I don't make any money. So anyway, I get back, go back to with to Duchess, Alberta, Canada for a week. And then I think we go to Saskatoon, I think, after that. Yeah, the next one was Saskatoon, and ended up, I think I was 88 in the long round and 94, 93 in the short round. And I won that one. And that was where it all kind of started. So I had enough money. All I had in my bank account was enough money to to pay my fees at that event. And I won, and I won it. And then the next week we went to another one. No, then what happened was, you will remember this. So that was the year at Fort Worth where about 15 guys got hurt in the Biltford. It was then called Biltford Tough Series.
It was Tough Edamans,
the Tough Edamans bull riding. And like 15 guys got hurt. So I got, because I'd won that event, I think I won $7,500. So I went way, I think I went to fourth in the touring pro standings. And so I got called up to go to Tacoma, Washington. So we went to Tacoma, Washington on Friday, Saturday night, and then Sunday there was a bull riding at Saskatoon, Saskatchewan on Sunday, and we flew back to that one, and I won that one as well. So I won two in a row, and then I was on the Biltford Tough Series, and that's how it all went.
Was it the Biltford Tough or the Bud Light Cup then?
No, it was Biltford Tough.
It was had already switched.
Yeah, I think it switched for like maybe a year before I came.
Mm.
So yeah,
man, culture shock. Texas to Edmonton. Denny Hay, Austin Beasley. I mean, you had the whole cultural experience.
Yeah. Well, I left Australia. The day I left Australia, it was 42 degrees Celsius.
Which is 100 and something.
100, maybe 20.
Yeah, that's like that. Hot.
Yeah, it's pretty hot. So then when I went to Canada, a week and a half later, I went to Edmonton, Alberta, it was minus 46 degrees Celsius. That's a culture shock.
Oh, it's so bad.
Yeah.
How would you, like, if you were, I do think, and I think this happens with a lot of riders. When you start looking at, I went through it with Paulo Crimber. When I started looking at him, we forget how good he was. Like, he was so good. And there's a lot of guys like that. I think you are in that category of, we haven't seen you in a while. We forget how steady you were for a lot of years. You know, how would you categorize yourself? Like, I don't know if that's a fair question, but I would think you'd look at yourself as a top tier. What's the best you ever finished world standard?
Sixth, I think.
Sixth.
Yeah.
That's amazing. To me.
Yeah, no, I mean, at that level, it is. It's, I mean, I know, I think, you know, there's several top 10s and plenty of top 15s and sometimes out of that as well. But I mean, I look at it now, it really makes me kind of like, now that I'm doing the TV and I look at how many qualifications people have had to the PBR World Final. So I went 10 times.
Mm-hmm.
And so guys like, you know, probably Chris Shivers and Ross Coleman and Luke Snyder, them guys kind of probably went maybe 12, 13 times. But like, it's probably going to be, I don't think you'll see guys go, you know, 10 times in for much anymore. Like these guys that are, so that's what I like the most about it. I was like, going, being able to qualify 10 times. And the one year I didn't, I got hurt. That was the year I got hurt and I didn't, I finished, I was an alternate. I think I finished, maybe that was when they dropped it down to 30 or something, 35 or something.
Yeah.
I think I ended up.
I kind of remember that. Yeah, I remember.
So I was
that.
Like 37th or 8th or something that year. So, but anyway, I don't know. I rode good, but I wasn't my. You know, it's kind of interesting. You know, my son asked me the other day after the bull ride, and we went to the bathroom, and we're in there, and he goes, "Daddy, were you as good as Jose Vitor Lemmy?" And I was like, "No, buddy." And I said, "I wasn't." He goes, "Well, but you were good." And I said, "Yeah, but I wasn't that good. I'm not that." I mean, granted, I don't think anybody's that good, but ever. But yeah, I mean, I don't know. It's hard for me to explain how I'd categorize myself. But
here's the other thing.
Put it this way, I could be put in the same. Sorry, I don't mean to cut you, but they could probably talk about me in the same conversations as some of them other guys, but not
absolutely. You know, steady, like you were just always there and you were always a threat to win, always. Yeah. You know, you were that guy. When you say a lot of guys now won't make it 10 times to the PBR finals, it's not as rider friendly. I don't care what any I did PBR finals first time in 1997. So when I start talking about nobody ever had to get on bulls like they are now. And people think I didn't see the old, I was there for all of them. And I've seen, you can watch video. It's, they're getting on stuff on a night that they maybe, if they don't have access to great bulls or they dumb it down, they're still, it is not very rider friendly for sure.
Yeah, we're all thinking and probably expecting we're going to see a lot more rides because we're in California. And sometimes the bull power, there's a lot of good bulls out here, but not as many of them. We thought we were going to see a lot more rides, but it's funny. I made the comment to Riley the other day about who picks all the bulls. I was like, you need to bring some easier bulls. And he's like, dude, I can't bring any. I said, well, how about you bring some 21 pointers? Like when I was riding, not the 21 pointers now, because there's a big difference. Like anyone, I tell people all the time, there was lots of good bulls, and it's not about there wasn't good bulls back then. It's about how many of them there are. Like, I mean, there was a bull we seen on the weekend there that of Julio Marino's. That's a bushwhacker son out of a troubadour daughter, a great bull.
Cherry Bomb's
his name. He is the coolest bull. Like, just he'd be one that, you know, you were going to win the round on back when I was, you know, 10, 15 years ago when I was riding. Now you're probably still going to win. You'll be good points on him, but there's plenty of other good ones to win the round on, you know. Like, it's just they're over a whole, they're better bulls, I think, these days. And that's why you see the last rides.
Yeah. That Jose, I'm going on a podcast very soon, Cowboy Shit, up in Canada with my friend Ted Stover.
Yeah.
And I'm supposed to bring my 10 best bull riders of all time. We're going to, he has the analytics, but it's an eye test, you know, it's an eye test because there's statistics but the eye test tells me, you know, and people will say his resume is not long enough. When Jose Vitor Lemme, when it's his turn, you just assume like, oh yeah, he's gonna. And then he takes a bull. People will say he's getting gifted because one guy's 86 on this bull and he's 89. It's a judged event because he gets more out of the bulls. Everything he does is spectacular.
Yeah, no, I agree. I'm like, so, okay. Like, I think about it. Like, I think in my career, I'm going to say, and this is before me too, but I'm going to say there's lots of really great bull riders. We can name them all, but in my words, Troy Dunn, Chris Shivers, Justin McBride, JB Mooney. They're the ones, they're the four, I think, during that they were all in several people's careers and they were all winners and they all were great. He's better than all of them, I think. And they're all my great friends. They're not just people I associated with. They're all my, so I'm not, and I think that Justin McBride, who I think was a winner and he could ride. But I think Jose Vitor Lemme just has something. It's crazy to me. It's something. And I talk about it on TV. He has something that makes people want to watch.
Yeah. Including me. And I've seen them all.
I agree. Yep. Yeah. You have. And that's what it's not like. I don't think like Troy Dunn was. Yeah. If you ran every rank bull there was there, that would be the one you'd be like, yeah, he's going to ride it.
Yeah.
So Jose has the same. He's that same guy.
Yeah.
Except he does it under pressure.
Yeah.
I just think.
Yeah. And here's the other thing he has. For one, he speaks English so well, there's barely an accent anymore, like yourself.
Yeah, that's awesome.
But we're on the airport shuttle. You know, they run buses for us now.
Yeah.
And he got on because we were waiting for his team. And he got on. I said, hey, he was kind of up there. I said, hey, thank you for the interviews. I said, I know I talk to you a lot. And he doesn't necessarily love to do it. But I said, thank you for doing that. I know it's a lot, but I appreciate you. And he goes, oh, yeah, yeah. I said, but I'm okay, right? I do a pretty good job. And he just kind of goes blank and he goes, you're getting better. You're getting better. You stick with me. I'll teach you. You're good. And I'm like, you smart ass. Like, he's funny too, you know?
Yeah. So
anyway, I don't want, and I did want to cover this towards the end, but you mentioned, you know, you use bull riding, you did well at bull riding and did well. You weren't just a bull rider, but an ambassador. You were well-spoken, always good on TV, always good interview. You were that guy. Everybody knew who you were. You know, we call Cord McCoy the most famous mediocre bull rider in the history of bull riding, but everybody loved Cord McCoy, and you weren't mediocre, but everybody knew your face to open up doors to be successful in something else. Rain Cow Horse, right? Those are the horses you're training. You are now, I remember when you were just getting going. Yeah, man, is Brendan Clark going to be okay at this? The horse training thing, it's going pretty well, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It's going really well. And it's a challenge every day. And, you know, you got to keep getting results. And, you know, it's probably, it's a lot like bull riding in a way where you just got to keep going. And, but, you know, I was lucky. Like I said, I think the PBR or my success in the PBR opened up a lot of doors because there was a lot of horse trainers that watched the PBR back in the day. And I mean, still do. And I think that, because I was Brendan Clark, the PBR bull rider, and that they would let me come ride with them. So I mm-hmm. went and bought a couple of my own horses early on and learned and trained them myself and learned how to do it. And I didn't do a very good job. But I went and got a lot of help, and you'd learn something and I'd go and get that good. And then I'd come back and learn something else and get that good. And then it just kept on going like that. And the first Snufflebit Futurity horse I had, which is our three-year-old competition, it's a lot like the ABBI in the Buck and Bulls. And the first one, I made the finals of the Limited Open, which is the lowest level. So there's four levels in the NRCHA. The Open is for everybody, but it's the top riders. And then Intermediate Open, it depends on how much money you've won, basically. So the Limited Open, I made the finals the first time. I went to the Futurity. So that was a big thing because, you know, that's, you know, it's hard to do as a young trainer. And then, you know, it just kind of went from there. The next year I had a good horse and didn't make the finals, but I went on the following year and won every event on him in the Limited Open. And then, so I had started having little bits of success like that. And then I went through like a stage where I had, people were sending me horses and that, you know, they were decent horses, but they weren't great horses. And I just wasn't, they weren't, you know, they were just okay. And then I was kind of at a stage where I was a little bit better. So I was against better competition. So I couldn't quite beat them. I'd be placing and stuff like that. And then I just kept at it. And I always would joke with all my horse trainer buddies is like, they, you know, at that lower levels, I was like, dude, they don't want to let me make the finals. Like, if I get into the finals, I've got them beat, because I was a pressure for me that it was so much easier. Like, I've got this weird thing where I trust in myself too much, I think. And I was like, I just go show my horse and I could outshow them through pressure. You know what I mean? So that was, you know, so I had some success like that. And then I finally, started getting good, like some really good customers who really loved the industry and let me go and buy some better horses and more expensive horses that, you know, obviously the better ones cost more money. And I did a good job of training them and made some finals. And then I finally, I went and I bought a horse for a customer that turns out that, you know, he ended up being like not a good horse. He's a great one. He's possibly one of the best horses in our industry in the country. And I was actually doing a photo shoot and video shoot with him here last night. And he's just unbelievable. But anyway, I won about 150,000 on him. And I won our NRCHA Derby last year, which is, other than the Snufflebit Futurity, is the biggest horse show in our industry. And I won all three levels on him there. And I won a California cow horse, had a big one, big show before that. And I won all three levels at that. And then I won the Hackamore Classic on him. And he's just I actually won Salinas. He's the one I finally got a Salinas buckle on.
Salinas, got your Salinas buckle. Yeah.
Yeah.
What's his registered name? First, what's his registered name?
His registered name is CR. He's a tough one. And he's by a horse called Woody Be Tough out of a mare called Cat Digs Lucinda. And he's a full brother to a horse that Justin Wright won the Snafflebit Futurity on. And yeah, so we've he's a cool horse. But then I've also had a lot of other good horses as
Wait,
well. But he's just a standout.
What's his barn name? What do you
His
call
barn name's Cowboy. We call him Cowboy. So the reason he got his name, my son names pretty much make names all the horses in their barn names. He's witty. They comes up with things, and it somehow seems to suit, you know. So, but Cowboy's owner was wanting to call him something else, and we I so he came from Bo a guy named Boyd Rice. So Boyd Rice is a very prominent horse trainer. He's $1 million rider in the Cutting and the Rankow horse. And anyway, Boyd Rice was. That was the ranch that raised this horse was Center Ranch is what they call themselves, and they're out of Centerville, Texas. And anyway, Boyd was basically their head trainer or one of their big trainers. And so this horse was started in his program as a 2-year-old, and we bought him out of the NCHA sale, a 2-year-old sale. And so Boyd's a cowboy, like he can rope and. He's a badass. And anyway, so I was like, kind of, Boyd's a cowboy. We kind of try and think of something more cowboyish. And Case and my son was like, Cowboy. We're just calling him Cowboy. And I was like, that's it. So anyway, that's his barn name. But yeah, he's a cool horse. He's a stallion that we started breeding him this year to some mares, and he's just, really easy. My son rides him. Anyone who follows my social media has probably seen. I just put a video of him up there riding him by himself the other day, and. Yeah, it's cool. So he changed my business and my wife and I's business, and he changed he changed the way everyone looked at me and the way that horses and the people send me horses, us horses, and quality. So
I passed on a line today that you said that you and I were talking about selling horses.
yeah.
And when it comes to an amount and people that don't understand say, how could you not take $250,000 for that horse? You're an idiot. And it was $250,000 won't completely change my life, but that horse
Right.
completely changed my life. Right. Was that similar?
Yeah, that's exactly how it was. I was like, someone asked me one, and I know this is a true sale. Like, I wouldn't advise the owner to take $3 million for this horse. And that's in the racehorse industry, that's not a big amount of money, but now, well, that's a lot. And the reason being is because she's financially okay. And the horse brings her way more joy than that money would. So it's not going to change her life anyway, the money, because by the time I get my commission and the other trainer gets their commission, she doesn't get that much money anyway. And so it's not going to change her life. And damn, the commission's damn sure not going to change mine. But that horse on a daily basis, if like it's hard to explain to people what they mean to you, but it's like a good bucking bull to means to an owner. I think I don't even know the people that know that own Whooper, the bucking bull, but I could imagine. I know that that bull changed their lives and made everyone know who they were, and it was exciting for them. So the horses are the same way. And I just last night, just what he's capable of doing and being able to. We did a photo shoot with him, and it's just his personality and what people what he you know. It's funny because that horse hasn't only brought enjoyment to us, but he's brought enjoyment to a lot of other people in the industry, which is really cool. It's like very similar to what the bucking bulls do. Like it, he so you're right. The value of them is just a number. It's the value really truly to them is what they bring you. And some people I don't think I'm going to get into the story of what that horse's owner has been through in her life, but he actually is he's an outlet, and he truly brings joy to her life. So money doesn't mean nothing compared to that, I think.
It's a good clip right there where you ended. No, I agree. And I passed that along today. And anyway, I enjoyed talking about that. But listen, before you chimed in on us today, I told the guys that are in the studio. They're not really the studio audience, but they know all the buttons to push. I said, Brendan and I are very good friends. He expressed himself well. Of all the podcasts I do, this will probably be one of the easiest as far as holding up my end of the bargain. And I was right. This is, you and I can sit, and I hope it comes across to people. We're bullshitting, man.
Yeah, like, that's it.
Like, I mean, we could do another hour and something else.
We didn't have this conversation on the weekend, but we actually did the last two weeks in a row, we've done this exact same thing. It wasn't even a podcast. We just sat there and bullshit. And so it's fun. We've always been like that. So because we like to talk about different things. It's kind of fun.
That's right. Well, it's good to see you, my friend.
You too, buddy. And I appreciate it. And thank you for allowing me to be the first Australian on here. I thought you would have had someone way more exciting and more famous than me, but I appreciate
name
that.
One.
Unless I can go down and say that.
Unless it's Keith Urban, you're the first man. Thanks, buddy.
Man.